morning, and welcome to worship with Lansing United Church. Thank you for being here this morning and taking the time to join us in person or online. And when I say thank you, I mean it, because church is a commitment, and it's setting aside that time every week, and I appreciate your time. And it's a lovely opportunity to gather, but I never want to take that for granted because you have to be intentional to make it part of your week. So thank you again. If you're watching at home and maybe you don't want to look at my face, you can just listen to the service and hike in the bush. And I have one friend for sure that does that. So there's lots of different options. I just want to remind folks as well that we have the hearing devices. And what happens is, if I use this, then it's connected right to your device. So if you would like one on a Sunday morning, just see someone at the back table and they would set you up with one. So if you're not using them, they're pretty easy. Joan just turns hers off when I get to the sermon. So I always hear that click, and I know she's tuned me out and she's listening to the Blue Jays or whatever. So please keep that in mind. There are lots of announcements in the bulletin. Next week here is the covenanting service, and it will probably be a little bit longer. We're looking for folks to help set up, serve, clean up, so please talk to Blanche if you have some time and can help out with that. I'll be on my best behavior. My mother will be here, so that will help with my anxiety level. But then I have therapy Monday morning, so it all comes together. It'll be just fine. So the covenanting service really is for us to celebrate our relationship together, and my commitment to working with you, my commitment to serve, and to walk together in this congregation. As part of this congregation. And our guest speaker, his name is Jesse James, and he is a fellow, he's a graduate of Tyndale College. He lives here in North York, for anyone who doesn't know him. I think he's a great preacher. He'll be coming, and he's just going to be talking about how community and faith can be woven together. Paul Stott from the region will be here, and together they will lead us through the service. So I think it'll be a nice opportunity. And I know Jesse's also bringing his wife and 3 kids, so we'll probably have some extra folks here, which will be kind of nice. So are there any other announcements that I'm forgetting? So I will use this opportunity for our land acknowledgement. As we gather together, we acknowledge the sacred land that we're on. It's been the site of human activity for more than 15,000 years. This land is the territory of the Huron, Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and most recently the Mississaugas of the Credit. The traditional territory that Lansing United Church is on falls under Treaty 13, agreed to by the Crown of England and the chiefs of the Mississaugas of the Credit. Today, the meeting place of Toronto is still home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful for this land that has been under their care. And our commitment to this land is to ensure that we create a place of inclusivity and welcome, a place where it is safe, where you can be your authentic self and explore your faith in community. And our pledge is to care for this land as a symbol of our desire to walk with Indigenous people in a spirit of reconciliation and respect. Now, something we do here, rather sort of like our call to worship, I just invite you, if you're comfortable, you're welcome to close your eyes, but just settle in and we just take a moment to breathe. Breathe in, feel your lungs expand and your heart open up, making room for new opportunities, meeting new people, taking risks, and trying things in new ways. Breathe out any pent-up feelings that have weighed you down in the last week. Let them go. free yourself to be open to the Spirit and this time of worship. Breathe in feelings of hope, of clarity, of new understanding. Breathe out feelings of superiority, the need to have it all, to do it all, to see it all. Breathe in the feelings of mystery and being comfortable with going with the unknown. Breathe in a sense of humility and the grace that allows others to shine. Breathe out any feelings of being hard on yourself. Breathe in God's gentle love. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. Boy, someone's on top. I was thinking we were almost out of matches last week, but someone has replenished them. I could get used to this. We light these candles as a reminder of God's presence. The Son that was sent, and the Spirit that moves in and through our lives. We light this candle as a commitment to being an affirming congregation, being a welcoming place for all. And we light this candle as a reminder as we journey with Indigenous people on a path of truth and reconciliation. Our grounding hymn, I like to call it, is Spirit Open My Heart, and it is printed for you, and we'll just sing it together. You remind us that we all have room for humility.
And we give thanks.
God of hope, vision, and dreams, give us equality for all. Amen. And our opening hymn is number 477, I Come With Joy. I invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll sing together.
Breaks bread and builds a share.
morning is tied up in our story. It's a long story. Some of you will know. It's a story that my nephews loved just because they could pile on when they and roughhouse and carry on and thought they had permission to do it. It's called Year of the Turtle, and it's one of Dr. Seuss's maybe less known stories, but it fits exactly with our scripture this morning. On a faraway island of Solomon Sand, Yertle the Turtle was king of the pond. A nice little pond, it was clean, it was neat. The water was warm, there was plenty to eat. The turtles had everything turtles might need, and they were all happy, quite happy indeed. They were, until Yertle, the king of them all, decided the kingdom he ruled was too small. "I'm ruler," said Yertle, "of all that I see, but I don't see enough. That's the trouble with me. With his stone for a throne, I look down on my pond, but I cannot look down on the places beyond. This throne that I sit on is too low down. It ought to be higher," he said with a frown. "If I could sit high, how much greater I'd be. What a king I'd be, ruler, I can see all I can see." So Yertle the Turtle, he lifted his hand, and Yertle the Turtle, the king, gave his command. He ordered 9 turtles to swim to his stone, and using these turtles, he built a new throne. He made each turtle stand on one another's back, and he piled them all up in a 9 turtle stack. And then Yertle climbed up, and he sat down on the pile. What a wonderful view! He could see almost a mile. "All mine," Yertle cried, "oh, the things I now rule. I'm king of a cow, I'm king of a mule. I'm king of a house, and what's more beyond that, I'm king of a blueberry bush and a cat. I'm Yertle the Turtle, oh, marvelous me, for I am the ruler of all that I can see." And although that morning he sat up there high, saying over and over, "How great am I?" until long about noon, then he heard a faint sigh. "What's that?" snapped the king. And he looked down the stack, and he saw at the bottom a turtle named Mac. Just a part of his throne, this plain little turtle. He looked up and he said, "Beg your pardon, King Yertle. I've pains in my back and my shoulders and knees. How long must I stand here, Your Majesty, please?" "Silence!" the king of the turtles barked back. "I am the king, and you're only a turtle named Mac. You stay in your place while I sit here and rule. I am the king of a cow and the king of a mule, king of a house, king of a bush, king of a cat. But that isn't all. I'll do better than that. My throne shall be higher," his royal voice thundered, "so I'll pile up more turtles, about 200. "Turtles, more turtles," he bellowed and brayed, and the turtles way down in the pond were afraid. They trembled, they shook, but they came, they obeyed. From all over the pond they came swimming by dozens, whole families of turtles with uncles and cousins, and all of them stepped on the head of poor Mac. One after another they climbed up the stack. Then Yertle the Turtle was perched up so high he could see 40 miles from his throne in the sky. "Hooray!" shouted Yertle. "I'm king of the trees, king of the birds, king of the bees, I'm king of the butterflies, I'm king of it all. Ah me, what a throne, what a wonderful chair. I'm Yertle the Turtle, oh marvelous me, for I am the ruler of all that I can see." Then again from below, in a great heavy stack, came a groan from that plain little turtle named Mac. "Your Majesty, please, I don't like to complain, but down here below we're in great pain. I know up on top you can see great sights, but down at the bottom we too have rights. We turtles can't stand it, our shells will crack. Besides, we need food, we're starving," groaned Mac. "Hush your mouth," howled the mighty King Yertle. "You have no right to talk to the world's highest turtle. I rule from the clouds, over the land, over the sea, but there's nothing higher than me." But while he was shouting, he saw a surprise, that the moon in the evening was starting to rise. Up over his head, the darkening sky. "What's that?" snorted Yertle. "Say, "What is this thing that dares to be higher than your holy king? I shall not allow it. I'll go higher still. I'll build my throne higher than I can and I will. I'll call some more turtles. I'll stack them to heaven. I need about 5,607. But as Zertel the king lifted his hand and started to order and give the command, that plain little turtle below in the stack, that plain little turtle whose name was just Mac, decided he'd had enough, and he had. And that plain little lad got a little bit mad. And that plain little Mac, little plain little thing, he burped. And his burp shook the crown, the throne, and the king. And you're the turtle, the king of the trees, the king of the airs, the king of the bees, the king of the house and the cow and the mule. Well, that was the end of the turtle king's rule. For Yertle, the king of Solomon Sam, fell off his high throne and fell plunk in the pond. And today that great Yertle, that marvelous he, is king of the mud. That's all he could see. And turtles, of course, all turtles are free, as turtles and maybe all creatures should be. Our prayer of confession is printed for you in your bulletin. We'll say it in response, and we're reminded we share it each week because it means something different to us each week. But it's also just about our basic humility, that none of us are perfect and are called to be gentle with each other. Loving God, when we see ourselves as a cut above others, loving God, when we insist on our own way, loving God, when we ignore the cries around us,
so that we may respond.
Loving God, when we are full of our own self-importance. Loving God, when we trumpet our own greatness. We pray that God does not let us get above ourselves, that we have the ability of self-reflection and to understand our ways and attitudes and to walk humbly with the way of the Lord. May God's pardon and peace be ours. Thanks be to God. Our next hymn is number 375, Spirit of Gentleness. Please stand as you're able and we'll sing together.
Thank you.
is a Sunday when you have to work. So you had to work to listen to Your Little Turtle. We sing Spirit of Gentleness, and sometimes I always think, boy, it's longer than I thought. But it really does walk us through our Christian path and calls us to go beyond just our stillness and to take risks. And and now Christy's going to share our scripture this morning.
Words from our ancient scriptures, from Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14, the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves, that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you this, man went down to his home, justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who are humble themselves will be exalted. May God bless this reading to our understanding.
Thank you, Christy. I love this piece of scripture, and it's always such a good reminder. Being too big for our britches. Do you remember that old phrase? I can remember my grandmother saying that to me from time to time. She thought that I was getting a little too big for my britches. She thought I was just getting a little ahead of myself, being a little bossy, making assumptions, thinking I knew it all, wasn't listening. By the time you know that I was a precocious little kid, and she was right, there were times when I was too big for my britches. I didn't know it all, and I wasn't in charge. She was the adult, and it wasn't all about me. If we wonder sometimes why church finds itself in the place we are today, with decreased numbers and lack of interest sometimes of younger people, the shying away from traditional church, our scripture in Luke gives us a hint, helps to answer some of the questions, and so does the story of Yergle the Turtle. Give us some answers and some insights. Somewhere along the line, we lost track of who we are. In the 50s, it was a wonderful time. Churches started power building, new churches popped up everywhere. There was hustle and bustle, a need for space, more room. If you weren't a church member, who were you? It was a common place to ask, oh, what church do you go to? Most of us today in the workplace wouldn't think of opening a conversation like that. But there was that sense that you needed that weekly guidance, you needed the weekly moral compass. It became the thing to do. And when you got a good dose of it, you were good to go for the rest of the week. But according to history, that was really an uncommon blip. It wasn't the norm. It certainly was a need for people to come together, to have community, and it certainly filled that need, which was amazing. But this today is a little bit more the norm. Smaller groups, working together, supporting one another, quietly reaching out, having to work a little bit harder to get our message, to compete with all of the messages out there in the world. Why would people come? Why do they come? And how do we share with them what's important to us? In 2022, some of these same churches that had vast numbers, they close in vast numbers. They can't seem to quite figure out how to reinvent themselves. And people start thinking, hey, I don't need to be told every week how to live my life. I don't need community to walk beside me. I'm in a running group. And they lose sight of the idea of working collectively. I can actually find that in lots of different ways but churches do continue to thrive and are progressive. Tomorrow or later tonight, I start a preaching conference, and it's a good opportunity. I think, what is the name of it? It's Finding Our Authentic Voice, or?
It's based on the Wounded Healer.
Yes, the Wounded Healer.
So,
yeah, the idea that, you know, leadership in church today is different. It's a different way of having to do it. And we all have to learn different ways. And it's also very humbling, because I am no preacher, so I get to listen to all these wonderful preachers and think, oh my goodness, I will strive to do better. So next week, not next week, I won't be doing the sermon, but the week after that, expect a 30-minute sermon of good, solid theology. So, it's also about helping people see to look at the relationships in faith that can grow. And it's not about being told what to believe, but walking, leading by example, sharing each other's story. We share our faith by grace and welcome. They want communication, sharing, working together in common goals. And that's what that opportunity is for us now in church, to do some of those things, to be able to share some of the work. Individual denominations sometimes think that our way is the only way. People that have stepped away from church and look at some of the older ways, they were afraid of judgments or what people would think or if they missed a Sunday. That's why it's so important for us now to say church is different. It wasn't bad, it was just what people did in churches earlier on, and things got done and lots of good work. But now we're realizing, and also our people are learning, that God's everywhere. If you have a chance to be on the golf course on a Sunday like today, I think you should be on the golf course. And God will be with you. But it's just a different way of looking at things. And I think that's part of our journey. Not taking the moral high road and thinking we know it all. And really, it does start with ministers and being open and being inclusive, because we don't know it all. There are more ways to interpret the Bible than we think, and it can be inclusive. And what about reading it together and sharing what it means as individuals? Jesus managed to keep his feet on the ground and led in such a way that was inclusive, welcoming, grounded in the everyday people. Last week we talked about the persistent widow, and Jesus cheered her on. Her questioning about authority, her persistence to be heard. These are important things. We're seeing that in Iran today, people making their voices heard. It's important to be heard. We can get so busy listening to all of these things that we do so well, and the things that paint us as good Christians, we can ramble off like the Pharisee. God, thank you that I'm not like those other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of my income to the church. I am the very best, a model of Christianity. He forgot to be a little bit humble. And the tax collector just fell down on his knees and humbled himself. He couldn't even look up at heaven. He beat his chest and said, God, be merciful to me. I am a sinner. I'm not perfect. I have flaws. You see that. I see that. And yet you love me anyway. You take me as I am. You see my list of good things. I don't have to show you the list. You already see it. You see my faults. You recognize what it is to be human. And I ask for your mercy on my journey. I wonder if somewhere along the line, we, the big church in general, cross that line from being too big for our britches. And the average first person felt like they sometimes couldn't keep up. All of these people doing all of these wonderful things and contributing, being so involved, come to church all put together. I can't live up to that each week. Some days I can hardly get out of bed. My kids aren't perfect. We fight all the way to church. I'm tired from working crazy hours. It's hard to keep up with the bills. Life is tough. Who can be that perfect? Meet those expectations. And if I can't be perfect all the time, then there must be no place for me in that perfect place. Just like our story this morning, the little turtle Mac at the bottom of the pile who tried talking to Yurda. He tried to say, hey, this is too much for all of us. We can't stand the pressure. It's all too heavy. And he couldn't take it any longer, and he finally burped. And it all came tumbling down. In church land, there actually has been a giant belch, and everyone's been startled. And some began to question and wonder if they need to be in church every Sunday. Is that the only place where God is? Is that the only way to connect with God? Can I still be a good person and not go to church? Now, I love church, and it fills my need on a Sunday morning, and for those, it's just about realizing some of the questions that people have asked themselves over the years. I find church a place of grace and mercy. I've been lucky. I've had wonderful experiences with church. And somehow there's been that perception, of that created holier than thou. But it's not everyone. However, young people do look at church as being a foreign place, where only a certain few go. And sometimes it's hard for them to see how they fit in. Church has become out of reach for some people. And you know what happened? They found out that they're okay without it. They found that they're okay without it because God is still present for them, but in different ways. And our job is just to say, you know, we can also do it in community. This scripture from Luke today is a tricky one, but it's an important one because it calls us all back down to earth. There's that fine balance between legitimately recognizing the good things that we do, acknowledging how we work together as a collective community of faith, make a difference in the community, in the neighborhood. It's all a wonderful thing. Sponsoring refugees, being a safe place for all, helping to get people fed, hearts can be changed, souls can be nurtured, peace can be offered. But at the end of the day, that's our call to do those things. We shouldn't expect that pat on the back. I always say when someone says, oh, thank you so much for doing that, I always say, oh, if I could do less, I would. At the end of the day, whether we're Christian or Muslim or whatever, I mean, we're just called to be humble and to pitch in and help. It's when we get too pious that we run into trouble. Too high on ourselves for doing what we're supposed to be doing anyway. It's all about being grounded in our faith, remaining in our call. It's easy to get swept away, cross that line between being humble and being too big for our britches. We have to be relentless in our welcome, so that all are included. People don't come on the first invitation to church. We just need to keep being out there and giving them opportunities and pathways into church and letting them know that there's good things going on here. People will say that I'm wonderful in pastoral care, but I'm only good in pastoral care because I have had amazing pastoral care offered to me. I have been nurtured, and I have been loved, I have been scraped off the floor. And from that example, I know what it feels like. and it makes me feel better, and how soul-filling it is. And from that, I've learned how to offer that up. In every pastoral care workshop, the bottom line message always is, show up. Just be present. Make yourself available. And that's our call, and that's what we all can do. If your little turtle had only gotten underneath all of the turtles and lifted them up, he would have seen how much more those far off lands. He would have seen the humanity. If the Pharisees would have shut his cake hole about all the good things he'd done, he'd recognize the humanity in the tax collector. Folks, we all walk that fine line. The church has always walked that fine line. And we can get too big for our bridges, but it doesn't mean we can't rein it in. God's love is abundant. It's all around us. God sees our imperfections, loves us anyway. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. Let's not get too big for our riches. Amen. Our next hymn is number 665, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Please stand as you're able, and we'll sing together. Gets to be because you've never been humbled until you've been at a nursing home and you're singing it and everyone knows the hymn. And you're so humbled because we're all going to get there. And here are these souls who were young and beautiful and probably never thought they were going to get old, and yet here they are, and we're helping them sing, and they sing their heart out. You should try it sometime. You'd love it. That hymn always sneaks up on me, and I think, oh. Our affirmation for your faith is printed for you in your bulletin. We'll say it together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who comes in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and to make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect and creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Our offertory hymn is printed for you. We'll sing it together. What we can do when we can do it. We all know that we're at different places in our lives, and we do what we can. And we offer up, beyond money and offerings, our time, our friendship, our listening ear, our donations to the Nearly New Shop, donations to the food bank, all of those things we contribute. And for those things, we give thanks for those blessings. Amen. Our prayer prelude is printed for you, and we'll sing it very fast. No, I'm kidding. I'm trying to keep to my 11 o'clock deadline. So if I sing you through a hymn really quick, you know what's going on. We'll sing together. We are reminded that we are not the end-all and be-all. You bless us into community with the responsibility to serve, support, and build one another up. Give us the courage and vision to not only see our dreams, but to also act on them. We give thanks for your steady presence, for the chance to see your love at work here and in the everyday. Help us to be our hands and feet on this earth, and empower others so that they too may find the joy in serving others. Guide us so that we may help others realize their dreams and see their visions and carry them out. We ask that you walk with those who are grieving, those lonely, those who are feeling isolated or have feelings of despair. Comfort those who struggle with things we have no idea about, struggling with their health, facing treatment, waiting for test results, just facing the regular aches and pains of growing older. God, we pray for those people who experience chronic pain or challenged by depression or addictions. And now in this moment of silence, hear our prayers, O God. God, we pray for those who are living without home. We pray for those who are living without clean drinking water. We pray for our politicians and ask that they make decisions on our behalf with integrity and compassion and justice. And we remind ourselves that their jobs aren't easy. We pray for our brothers and sisters who celebrate Diwali tomorrow, and for some who will be celebrating tonight, the celebration of light and food and love. God bless the children of this world and all of the children in our lives, the little ones and the fully grown ones who remain dear to their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents, wherever they live in the world. We give thanks for our service personnel who work tirelessly in the community and throughout the world, providing medical services, emergency response, police and fire protection. Keep our roads and waters safe. Work for peace throughout the world. God, help us to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, be the light for the prisoner, give shelter to the homeless. And now we lift our voices up to you in the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn is number 639, One More Step Along the World I Go.
Thank you.
message I One message I did forget to pass on is you get greetings from Reverend Brian Ransom. He had hoped to be able to preach this fall here with us one Sunday, but he's engaged at Lakefield United Church until Christmas. So he's looking forward to the new year to be able to come in and preach and be able to visit with everyone. So that was the update this week. Our closing prayer is printed for you in your bulletin. We'll say it together. God, you write your love upon our hearts. Lead us from here, ready to take up your call to peace and justice. Help us to be persistent in our love. Keep us open to the joys and responsibilities of creation. Help us to be engaged in the everyday workings of this world. Bless those we love and those we don't, keeping all of us in your care. Amen. Folks, go from here. Go from here feeling the peace of Christ, knowing you are loved unconditionally, and enjoy this beautiful weather that's offered up to us. Amen.